I'm saying for this, where's that? The door is a lot more well, I'm waiting to see what this is.
I know that we can't get in, huh? Hey.
No, good morning.
How are you? Hi. How are you doing? I'm Gail Troyer.
Hey, nice to meet you, Gail. Bill Finch.
Good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
How's it looking for you?
Looks pretty good. We're excited about our numbers. This is my wife, Leah.
Hi, Leah. How are you? Nice to see you. You
met the Reverend.
Yes. Nice to see you.
My pleasure,
believe
us.
Thank you. You never know till the final vote, but.
That's right.
You know, well, come on.
Now, we have an abridged meeting this morning because you all don't want to sit outdoors hearing me rattle and rattle and rattle on. This guy's awesome. This guy's awesome. Oh, here, does somebody want a chair? I don't need this. Somebody help me move this around. We'll turn it around. I don't know what we were thinking. There we go.
Perfect.
Very good. Okay, so before we, our speaker today, of course, Bill Finch, running for Solicitor General. All right, the only other announcements we have is the GOP will have a headquarters, we believe, opened on July 1st, and it will not be locked down. Because I'll have a key. Also, want to remind everybody the runoff election's coming up. That's why we have a speaker here today. Turnout was not great in the last election. And, you know, we got a young friend, Justin Hawkins. Some of you know Justin. He did a Facebook post about a week ago talking about how many people the day of the election that young man was either calling, driving, harassing, or in all shapes or form getting to the polls. If any 10 of us, if any 20 of us, behaved that way on election day, we could generate hundreds and hundreds more folks voting. So runoff elections are notorious for people not knowing about them. Only the grassroots is going to get it out. We would like a good turnout. Good turnout will show strength for the GOP, so I encourage everybody to, whatever you can do in a positive manner, Facebook, tweet, post, write to folks, email, but let folks know we still have a runoff. With all that, since we are in a bridged meeting and it's very hot, we have a great speaker, Bill Finch, and we're still down to coffee and drink. But Bill, want to take us away?
Thank you, Brad. I appreciate you inviting me to speak in front of y'all. This reminds me of when I was a child and we had our outdoor revival in our tent meeting. So I'll try to keep it a little bit shorter than the good Reverend did. My name's Bill Finch. I'm running for Solicitor General here in Forsyth County. And I was trying to think about what is important to the Republican Party and what I could do to get this message out. And I happened to see the same post that Brad was just referencing. And as I began to read it, I started thinking, well, whose fault is that we aren't getting out there and we don't have the right candidates, we don't have the right people in the positions of authority and in positions of leadership? And I started thinking, well, it's the Republican Party's fault. It's Brad's fault, it's Joel Nat's fault, it's Carolyn's fault, it's Reva's fault, it's Bob Rourke's fault, it's all of it. Then all of a sudden I started thinking, you know what? No, it's not. It's not their fault. They're the ones that are out there getting out and doing things. You know whose fault it is? It's folks like me. Because my belief in the past was that, hey, all I did was show up and vote. I've done my part. I've done my duty. End of story. And I started thinking as I read along with this post, I'm not doing what I ought to be doing. That I'm not aggravating people. I'm not calling them up. I'm not putting them in my car and driving them to the polls and informing them. Most folks don't know about the elections, and they don't bother to inform themselves. So whose job is it? It's my job. It's your job. It's everybody's job out here to inform people as to, number one, when the elections are. Be nice to know that. And a lot of folks say, well, when is it? And what I tell them now is July 22nd is the last day you can vote. I don't say July 22nd is election day because that's the way it was in the past. But now we have 3 weeks of early voting. We have a Saturday vote, and we have election day itself, which is July 22nd. But that's the last day that you can vote. Now, if I were to come up to you and tell you, I'm going to tell you what kind of house you're going to live in, you'd look at me like I was nuts. If I told you that I was going to tell you what kind of car you were going to drive, you'd look at me like I was nuts. If I told you how you would wear your hair, what kind of clothes you were going to wear, you'd look at me like I was nuts. But over and over and over, we let other people tell us who our leaders are going to be. Why? We don't let them tell us what kind of phone service to have, what kind of cell phones to use, but things of the utmost magnitude, we let them routinely tell us who is going to make decisions on our behalf. And so I have not done what I should have been doing. I have not rallied the troops. I have not, and this is, of course, my perspective has changed, being in the race. And that post, it got me to thinking, well, I've been blaming the wrong people. You know, when 20% of registered voters are deciding for the rest of us, there's a problem. We need to be involved more. I need to be involved in this party. Win or lose on this election, I need to be involved in this party. I need to be, you know, and part of that post, you know, as I was reading down along through the thread, I saw my friend Carolyn's post about stopping off at, you know, going to meetings, stopping off at racetrack, and as she's going in there to go get a water, she's still pushing push cards to folks. So she's always campaigning. Now, campaigning sometimes has a negative connotation to it. You know, think, oh, it's campaign, it's politics. She's informing, she's rallying. She's getting folks out there interested in knowing who our leaders are, what they're and what they stand for. Now, what folks stand for leads me into my next topic here, and that's my opponent. Folks have asked me, well, how can it be that somebody with her past can be involved in the Republican Party? And it's the Republican Party's fault to vet these people. That, now, it's not the Republican Party's duties and responsibility. The duties and responsibilities to make sure that somebody like that doesn't get elected. Ours. My responsibility. It's your responsibility. Now, she has worked for Cynthia McKinney. She is one of the most polarizing political figures in the United States history. And it's not just simple politics, it's anti-American. She has omitted, tried to hide, tried to suppress her work for Miss McKinney, and then when that didn't work, she tried to explain, to massage the message, to twist it around, to say, oh, well, it was just an internship. So I left that part of my history and tried to hide that from you because it was just an internship. Well, if you take a look at the application she submitted to the governor, she did talk about all of her work history. One of the things that she included was an internship with the district attorney's office. So right off the bat, we already know that the fact that it was an internship is not the reason why she suppressed it, or at least tried to suppress it. Because I can assure you that if the internship had been for Paul Coverdale, it would have been included. Now, after that was exposed, she tried to massage the message again, that it was a college internship. And later still, some of her financial supporters have tried to massage the message a third time, that it was a college internship for which she had no control, that it was selected for her. But my opponent had to send in to the governor an application, and in that application it says that she graduated in May of 2001. So for it to have been a college internship, she would have had to work for Miss McKinney prior to May of 2001. The problem with that is she did not begin to work for Miss McKinney until October of 2001. We all know what a hard and trying time was in the United States in October of 2001. We're less than 30 days removed from the 9/11 attacks, less than 30 days. She goes to work for Miss McKinney, and during that time, Miss McKinney is starting in on her fiery rhetoric. She's accusing our president of complicity in the 9/11 attacks. Miss McKinney is filing articles of impeachment against George Bush in the House. And my opponent thought so highly of this fiery anti-American rhetoric that she decided that she was going to donate to her campaign. She financially supported Miss McKinney. She worked for her. If it was an internship, she felt so much for Miss McKinney that she decided that she was going to work for free. But don't be fooled by that, because not all internships are unpaid internships. And so what we have sat on the sidelines and let this happen to us. We've sat here. We haven't gone to meeting after meeting after meeting and pushed folks and aggravated them and informed them as to who is trying to infiltrate our party. If it's not important, let's all just pack up and go home right now. But folks who show up at 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning are the folks who believe in this party. Folks who understand that we cannot let those people with Democrat values run our party. And who's been responsible for that? I have. I haven't rallied troops. I haven't gotten back behind our past leaders and helped decide and helped shape who our leaders are going to be. So if it's not important, let's just go home. Let's have a cup of juice and just call it a day. But the party's important. The party's important to you. The party is important to me. I have spent my whole life being shaped. Sometimes I didn't realize it, but I was being shaped to do this. I was being shaped to be in this party. Now, some of the shaping I didn't like. It was done by my parents. My dad was the principal of my high school in a 3,000 person town.
Oh, God.
I never got away with anything. I didn't get to say dad or mom. My mom was an English teacher too. I didn't get to say I don't feel good. Unless, you know, doctors were involved, I was in school. But I didn't appreciate what that was. And it was probably, you know, into my early 20s before I realized, you know, my dad and my mom are not the dumbest people in the world. In fact, they're probably some of the smartest people. And so to this day, as I approach my 50th birthday, when I look at my parents, I think, you know what? You were just so ungrateful for what they did. They didn't let you, you know, ride around and hang out and do those things that kids do that eventually lead to trouble. So to me, it was a restriction on my freedom. To them, they were shaping my life and my value system. And after graduating from college and being shaped by my parents, I was shaped by my first job, and that was with the Fulton County Police Department. I did that for 8 years. It's my belief that you ought not to ever give a 21, 22-year-old boy a fast car and a shiny badge and a gun. But those folks lay their lives out on the line every single day, and we had our incident down here at the courthouse on June the 6th of this year, 5th or 6th. And so it's long periods of boredom in police work, punctuated by intense moments of terror. And I witnessed firsthand what victims go through when they are subjected to crime. When those folks who don't want to live within the rules that we have as a society have put together, the rules that my parents had me live under, I saw how it can rip apart people's lives, the impact that it can have upon them. Crime has visited my family, and so I know. I can see into people's eyes the pain, the impact that crime has upon them. And after 8 years, while I was policing, I decided that I was going to go to law school. And I did policing full time, and I went to school full time. I was married, and I had a child. And I was an idiot for doing all of that at once. But I got the greatest wife in the world, my wife Leah. If you want to step up here just a minute, let everybody see you. It's my wife Leah. She stood by me. She has encouraged me. She has helped, or to a large extent, raised our children, and I've assisted. She's done a great job with them. We're very proud of them. So after law school, I became a prosecutor here in Forsyth County. My wife Leah and I decided that we were going to move from Sandy Springs, where I live. We didn't want to raise our children in the type of environment that I saw day after day after day. I didn't like the education system, and I did not like the crime that was occurring, even in a place that was as nice as Sandy Springs. So we began looking, and most of that was she was looking. She found a house up here in Forsyth County, and so I then started looking at the education system. And although we loved the house, it was the education system that brought us here, and the way of life. This is what we are invested in. We've invested in this community for about 20 years. We've raised our children here. We've educated our children here. And so each and every step of the way, my parents have prepared me for this. My first job prepared me for this. I became a prosecutor here under Judge Abernathy Maddox, and that has prepared me. I have done defense work, and defense work is quite a humbling job. The facts are usually not on your side. And so I've had to approach crime from the standpoint of having a heart. You cannot, and I don't think the people here want an iron-fisted prosecutor. What this county wants is somebody who has been shaped by his parents, by his religion. I grew up Methodist, but my wife convinced me to go to Brownsbridge Community Church. It took me a while to get used to not having to stand up, sit down, open the hymnal, and that sort of thing. But Brownsbridge has been absolutely great. That has helped shape my life. It's justice that the people want. And justice is not always an iron fist. Justice, most of the time, is tinged with mercy. Being able to recognize that there are some folks, based on individual circumstances, who need to have their case treated differently than somebody else. And it's not because they grew up in such and such a neighborhood, or they're related to so and so. It is because of the individual facts of the case, their age, their past criminal history. So all of these things, time after time after time, even though sometimes I didn't recognize it, it shaped me. So I am starting to get out there and get the support of the people, people who decide that they want to make the decisions for what's important to Forsyth County. I've been getting support from Commissioner, been getting support. I'll have to, at this time, recognize Susan. Susan, if you could stand up, please. Susan has... I think y'all all know Susan. Susan ran a good, hard, clean race. She did a great job in getting out the issues that are important to you to inform the voters. And I learned a lot from her because she got out, to a large extent, a message that folks find repulsive. That Miss McKinney could have such an impact on Forsyth County. My folks are the ones who shaped me. My faith is what shaped me. What shaped my opponent? What would cause her to do that? And some of her supporters have said, well, you have to understand the demographics of where she came from. Well, you have to understand where she lived. Where she lived was a man-made drawn line. Man decided that this is what this county is going to be. And her supporters have said, you have to understand the people inside that man-made line. So that was why she was a Democrat. That's why she supported their causes. That's why she voted for their candidates. Well, that seems like a bunch of hogwash to me, but let's assume for a minute it's true. Man-made line is why she was a Democrat. Well, guess what? She's renting here in Forsyth County in another man-made line. Is she only a Republican because of this man-made line? You don't. Character matters. Our past shapes us and helps define what our character is. Character and who you are isn't affected by man-made lines, hand-drawn lines. So you think about it. Do I get out this message? Do I aggravate my neighbor? Do I send that annoying email because we don't want to be that person? Well, we have to let folks know. We have to let folks know who is trying to infiltrate this party. If this party's important, we have to become annoying. We have to become aggravating. We have to become that guy. And I'm telling you right now, I'm willing to be that guy. Forsyth County deserves better. I intend to let my past guide me in my principles. And I'm always reminded, and it's just one message among many that have resonated with me from our pastor. And so I want all of my decisions to be shaped by a message that he delivered to us. And that is, based on our past experiences, and based on our current circumstances, and based on our future hopes and dreams, what is the wise thing to do? So that's going to be my guiding principle each and every step of the way when I'm creating a budget, step by step by step, based on my past experiences, my current circumstances and future hopes and dreams. How do I set the budget? Based on those three things, how do I treat defendants? How do I lead Forsyth County based on those three things? Those will always guide me. Now, I will tell you that there's a lot of damage that can be done to people with bad cops and bad prosecutors, bad leaders. I intend to hire very strong lawyers, but very first of all, they're gonna have to be good people. Because if you're a strong lawyer and a bad person, there's just too much damage that you can do to this county. I won't stand for it. The Forsyth County people won't stand for it. They're gonna have to agree with me that these are the principles that are gonna shape each and every one of our decisions. And so I'm gonna ask and I am going to demand that we become that annoying and aggravated person, because I'm Bill Finch. I'm running for Forsyth County Solicitor General. I want and I need and I demand your vote. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
You're in charge of the dollars.
Bill Finch for Solicitor.
I hear you.
Hey, give one to your
annoy,
mom.
Aggravate. Get them stirred up. All right.
Okay, these are much tinier than yours.
Go give them out. Okay.